DavidIke.com, and if you have a chance, don't miss David. He's coming to the U.S. to make several stops. It's a life-changing, unforgettable experience, and he's been at it so long. He has so much information, and I can see how an all-day event would literally have people walking out, different people. Here's something, David, that I found. You mentioned Dr. Day and Orwell talking about things that were off in the future. This I found this years and years ago, and I have kept it ever since. It's fascinating. It's called Jules Verne's Dark Vision of Modern Life. You may not know about this, but it's fascinating. Let me read just a little bit of this, if I might. This is 1835, and this was written was 1863. What happened was a manuscript that was written by Jules Verne was rejected by his publisher, and it ended up being stuck in a safe, all right? And it was found in 1994 and was ultimately published. When it was written, Jules Verne was only 35 years of age, with one highly acclaimed book to his credit. When he began writing, and the book was called Paris in the 20th Century, by hand, no typewriters yet, his pages were illuminated by a small gas lamp as he worked away. Electric lights still 15 years off in the future. Now get this one. The book's protagonist is named Michel Dufresnoy. He lived nearly a century into the future in this particular book. This is a future vision book that he's writing. The year was 1960. And as Verne wrote it, technology and automation had supplanted the culture of the 1800s. Elevators whisked people up and down buildings. Now remember, this is 1865 he's writing this. Elevators took people up and down tall buildings. Trains took them back and forth from the suburbs. Images, he called them facsimiles, this is 1865, could be sent thousands of miles away by what he called photographic telegraph. He predicted fax, something we might today not bat an eye over. Neon lights, unknown in 1863, illuminated Verne's avenues in Paris. Concerts were performed in 10,000-seat auditoriums by single artists using electric amplifiers. And of the, this is a quote now, of the innumerable cars that passed on the paved roads, most moved without horses. And he wrote this 25 years before the first prototype automobile ever appeared. He said they were propelled by an invisible force, the force of 20 or 30 horses by means of a motor run by gas combustion. Verne's heroes, however, and this is the dark side, quote, no longer stood in admiration of these marvels, end quote. He went on to say they just quietly took advantage of them without being any happier because of their speeded pace and their American passion. One could feel the devil of money pushing them forward nonstop and without mercy. Jules Verne, 1863.
Well, that was spot on, wasn't it? It's amazing how many examples come up of how the future is predicted and how different people access that future, you know, maybe different, but one key way is that that future is projected by this hidden force. And the thing that much of the alternative media is going to have to face, as a lot of it already does, is that there's a question here, which I asked 20-odd years ago. When you look at how this this transformation of the world is unfolded step by step, and how people have been born, served this agenda, died, then other people have come in and served this agenda and died, and they were never going to see this this thing reach its fruition. So why would they do it? And why would they do it generation after generation? There has to be a common theme, a common force, which spans all these generations that have incessantly has pushed this agenda on, no matter who's been in the White House, who's been in Downing Street, who's right. been the CEO or whatever. There's this, and there's a force in the background. And, you know, when you look at ancient accounts and the accounts of ancient cultures and the oral and other history that has passed through to present time, across the great spectrum of different peoples, there is a common theme. Christians call it demons. Islam calls them jinn. Gnostics call them archons. The Zulus call them Chitahuri, but the big penny drop is that they are talking about the same force. It's a force in the hidden, which is manipulating human society. And these people who are serving this agenda, generation after generation, pushing it on, that which knows what the future is designed to be long before that future unfolds, they are just vehicles for this force to impose that future step by step. Mm-hmm. And if you are part of that network, or you can tap into it in some way, then you can predict the future, because you are simply saying what the plan is. And like we said at the start, unless there's an intervention, that plan will happen. And so it's this force which even much of the mainstream, the alternative media, will not look at, because it is closed to anything beyond human, much as the mainstream is. I mean, you know, I've been ridiculed and dismissed for what I'm saying in these deeper levels of
oh, have you ever
by the alternative media as much as I have by the
yes.
by the mainstream, because that too is in a mind prison. It's a perception prison, and it needs to open its mind up, if we're going to really understand what's going on, to the fact there is a common force that spans these different people coming in and out, serving this agenda. What is that force? Because clearly it exists. Google is an absolute monster, just like Facebook and all these internet giants that are merely the internet outgrowth from the mainstream media of newspapers, radio, and television that we had before, controlled again by the same networks. And, you know, as newspapers fall in terms of their circulations and will eventually go out of business in the face of the electronic media, well, nothing changes, because the electronic media is controlled ultimately by the same networks that have controlled the newspapers, etc., up to this point. This former investigative journalist on the News of the World was telling me how that was structured, and how the paper she worked on was structured in this compartmentalized way. Mm-hmm. But basically, the journalists have no idea where the line of the newspaper is coming from, where the decisions of what they will report and what they won't report and how they will report it are actually coming from, because they only know the next level up. They don't know where it's really coming from.
Well, it's the same thing as a teller in a bank, the person at the window that takes your check and gives you cash. They don't know what the managers know. The managers don't know what the district managers understand, the corporation execs. They don't, and most of them don't even know about the Federal Reserve. They never even heard about it. Now, maybe they've heard about it, but they don't understand any of it. Here's another thing. You mentioned Google. This is really critical. Google, I've been saying for a long time, Google is God, lowercase. Google is God. Google is such an enormous monstrosity on the planet. It is so evil. Google, just so you know, ladies and gentlemen, Google workers had 427 meetings at the White House over the course of Obama's 7.5 years in office, averaging more than one a week. Why? Ask yourself, why 427 meetings at the White House? What's going on with Google? There you
yeah,
go.
Something similar, not that much, not that many, but something similar happens with the British government as well. And what Google have done is changed the name of much of their company to Alphabet to hide the extent of Google, because Google is such a buzzword in people's minds and so well known that when you see Google everywhere, I mean, what's Google doing in robotics? What's Google doing in transhumanist technology?
Genetics, so all of it.
They changed the name to Alphabet, so that Alphabet is such a terrible name, but it's a name you can easily forget, and it's not a buzzword like Google. So they're just hiding the extent of what that Google giant monster is actually doing. And this is all fundamental. This DARPA Google connection is fundamental to what we were talking about earlier about this transhumanist agenda, because you know Kurzweil. Is talking about having people connected to their minds connected to the cloud, as he calls it, by 2030. And you know, I've got a new book out called Phantom Self, which refers to the fake self-identity. We are awareness. We are the state of being aware. We are infinite awareness. That's what we are. Everything else is detail. But Phantom Self is the self-identity with your name, your race, your income bracket, your country, your religion, whatever, and which basically is the conscious mind perception of self-identity, and that focus of attention on what I call phantom self, self-identity. I am my name. I am my race, and all that stuff. Disconnects us, that focus, from the greater, an influence of the greater consciousness beyond this program reality. But what I'm, there's a chapter in the book, and I call it transphantomism. And I call it that because it's taking this disconnection from conscious mind, self-identity, disconnection from between that and expanded awareness to a whole new level by connecting the conscious mind and what we call the human level, if you like, by connecting it to this this technological sub-reality that they're creating, which Kurzweil calls the cloud. The idea of transhumanism is to connect people technologically to this cloud, so the cloud does their thinking for them, so they get everything from the cloud. This AI, artificial intelligence, running this whole technological grid, this cloud, becomes basically the mind that is dictating the perceptions of the population. So the idea is that people become nothing more than a biological computer terminal on this cloud, which the internet is fundamentally a part, of course. Mm-hmm. And it's unfolding all the time, and they're telling us. I mean, it's not that they're hiding it anymore.
No.
People like Kurzweil are telling us, and they're telling us on the basis of the sales pitch, which is, by doing this, we'll become superhuman, but we won't. We'll become subhuman. That's the whole idea. And what they're doing is they're taking us, you know, here, kitty, along this road where they start out with what you might call holdables, the smartphones and the tablets. They move on then to what they call wearables. These are the smart watches and the Google Glass and the Bluetooth. And now they're moving into what they call implantables, more and more and more. They're getting inside the body. Uh-huh. And the idea is to use that implanted technology, which people accept willingly because it makes me superhuman, to connect them to this technological sub-reality run by artificial intelligence. That's where this is going. That's what transhumanism is all about. And part of this,
they're taking away their humanity, David.
Exactly.
They're taking what's left.
It's part of this whole agenda is to create the synthetic human, which has does not procreate. That's done again technologically in laboratory means, exactly what Aldous Huxley predicted in Brave New World. This is why they are having these great studies to create a synthetic human. This is where a lot of this, and even the end of sexes even, is where they want to go. So we're seeing the move in front of our eyes day after day. Oh, here's the latest technology and everyone wants one. Let's queue in the middle of the night to be the first to get the next level of control. We're seeing in front of our eyes the destruction and the disappearance of everything that we've accepted to be human up to this point. So there is no human left. That's the idea.
That's where they're taking us. Yeah.
It's this force in the background that we talked about earlier that so much of the alternative media just dismisses and don't want to talk about. It's this force that's behind it. What we see, the people we see who are doing it, are merely the vehicles for this force. We need to understand very, very urgently what's going on here, because we're being taken along this road and so many people are walking along it. I mean, you know, the addiction to this technology is so fantastic.
It is.
For me, there's something coming off it. There's something coming off it in terms of some kind of artificial intelligence, whatever you want to call it. There's something coming off it that is making this addiction even more fierce and extreme than it would otherwise be.
It's an addiction to, it's a dehumanizing addiction that is bizarre to watch, because the sheep don't get it. And there's some smart sheep out there. They still don't get it. They think this technology is going to make them, as you said, superhuman. No, it's going to make them subhuman. It's gone.
Exactly. And we're being led along this road. And, you know, if you're in any way awake, it's an open book. But if you're not, if you are addicted to the phone, and of course, what generation is addicted to phones more than any other is the younger generations, of course, who are being brought up from birth now. I mean, you see grotesque sights like I saw recently in a restaurant where the parents are having their meal. And this baby in a high chair playing with a smartphone.
No.
It's a baby. Extraordinary.
Yeah, shame on those parents. Oh, they'll never get it.
But that's where we go. This is the most important thing for people to understand at the moment, and is this transhumanist agenda for connecting us to a technological reality that will do our thinking for us. And it's not just me saying that. Kurzweil saying that. Mm-hmm. Kurzweil saying that what will happen is that we'll be connected to this, what he calls this cloud, and then gradually the cloud will do more and more of our thinking until there's no human left. Saying that.
Yes, yes. AI will be your friend. AI will bury you. That's what will happen.
This is the question. This is the question that I ask in these talks and put forward some answers to it. What is AI? This is the question. I don't hear this being asked. What is AI? It's this buzz phrase, artificial intelligence. Mm-hmm. Artificial intelligence will run fighter planes, will run the internet, will run this, will
make
run
your
that.
Hamburgers for you.
Yeah,
with
exactly.
Robots.
So then we ask the question, what is this artificial intelligence? Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you what my answer is. This artificial intelligence is basically that which has been manipulating this world from the hidden for so long. It's a technological vehicle which humans are being manipulated to create, the smart grid and the smart technology and the based on Wi-Fi, the cloud. Mm-hmm. It's a vehicle that's being created for this hidden force, which has been given the name in this context, artificial intelligence, to take the frickin' world over. And by connecting humanity to the cloud, taking every human mind over. That is what's happening. And of course, much of the alternative media even doesn't want to go there. This is what's happening, and we need to understand it.
What a critically important thing, and I hope all of you will remember that as you make your way along. It is being pushed at us around the clock in ways that we're not even, I don't even see. These people have planned this for so long, and they're so damn clever about it. And there are, of course, EMF issues, embedded frequencies in every kind of electronic medium. that can be used. I believe personally that the electric grid, David, is being used as a vehicle to put frequencies that will influence the masses. We're surrounded by wiring in our homes. We know that the electric grid can carry television, radio, cable TV, but it's not because those industries are separate. But the electric grid is not being discussed. And I tell this quick story. A friend of mine, Dr. Pat Flanagan, you know Pat, no other.
Yep.
He went over to a friend's house. He walked into the garage. The guy was a kind of a garage genius, and he had a scope on, and there was a particular wave on this oscilloscope. And Pat recognized it immediately as the Lilly wave. And he said, "What are you doing with the Lilly wave? You know, what kind of work are you doing?" And the guy turned and looked at him, and he was kind of shocked, according to what Pat said. And he says, "You never guess where that's coming from." And Pat said, "Where?" And he pointed to the wall plug. He said, "It's in the electric grid, and it didn't just get there by itself."
This is precisely what's happening. Whether it's that, or whether it is the astonishing increase in atmospheric technologically generated radiation, whether it's this smart technology, whether it's the Wi-Fi cloud, which of course they're putting satellites up now to make sure there's no area of the Earth that's not covered by Wi-Fi
of the world.
Yeah, and this is not clearly not so that everyone, even in the desert, can be on the grid, on the web. It's because the cloud is the technological sub-reality in all its various forms, including the electrical grid. And therefore, they need to make sure no one can escape anywhere from the cloud, which
nowhere
they are
to hide.
Designed to be connected to. This is what's happening. We're seeing a whole sub-reality being created, which humanity is planned to be tapped into, and therefore the ability to expand your awareness beyond that cloud will then be closing in on near impossible. That's the idea. That is what's happening in front of our eyes all the time as this technological society goes on moving. And if you've got to connect the dots. You've got to connect the dots with it, and then you see the picture. If you just see it in isolation, it's just this technological madness or addiction to smartphones. Oh, that's not good. And oh, do you know all these studies that show that this technological these technological smart sources are rewiring the brain so that they have a lower attention span, etc. Oh, that's not very good, is it? Well, connect all the dots. Connect what Kurzweil is saying. Connect all the dots, and you see what's happening. And that is what I've just described.
Well, summed up remarkably, the cloud. It sounds like a sci-fi movie plot. The cloud takes over human consciousness, takes over humanity, takes over the planet. We're run by the cloud after 75% of the world population is destroyed in the coming World War III. The cloud. What
a
vision.
Something else that Kurzweil says is nanobots, these nanotechnologies, also known as smart dust and many other names. Nanobots will infuse all matter around us with information. Rocks, trees, everything will become these intelligent creatures. In other words, they'll become this part of this whole control system, this whole sub-reality.
Yeah.
So how are they infusing everything, rocks, trees, everything, as he says, with these nanobots, with this nanotechnology? Well, one of the ways they're doing it is chemtrails. That's one of the things that's coming out of chemtrails, is nanotechnology on a vast scale, in other ways too. All this nanotechnology in food and everything, it's just passing it out and putting it in human bodies and putting it in the environment to as part of this whole new technological what they want to be eventually, a synthetic world full of synthetic people connected to a technological control system.
Yeah.
That's where we're going. And you know, they're not talking about, you know, 100 years from now. Kurzweil is talking about this basically being in place, or at least the start of it, by 2030.
They're in a hurry. They're in a hurry,
Jeff, for the reason we talked about earlier. They know humanity is awakening to a more expanded view of everything. Mm-hmm. And although this technological control system has been planned all along, by this force outside the human realm, the desperation and the speed that they want to push it in is motivated by knowing that there is a limit on how long they can not get this control before humanity is awakened enough to see the game in enough numbers to make a difference. So this next period, this next 3 years will be very, very important, but the next 10 years will be extremely important to where this world goes.